Good morning, Life Church family and friends. We're excited about what God is doing in our lives, and we just appreciate you coming online with us this morning. We just pray that you'll be blessed. So much is going on. We know God's in control. And so we want to pray and open up the service and have some praise and worship. I want you just to enter in right where you're at. Just begin to enter into the praise and get ready for the word and get prepared for what God is bringing in and what God's going to be doing in your life this morning. So let's just open up in prayer. Father, we thank you for this time this morning. We just pray that you anoint this place, anoint this time. And Lord, we thank you that we're coming against this coronavirus, Father God. And we're speaking death to that coronavirus right now, Father God. It cannot exist, and Father God, that we're just believing miracles begin to take place in people's lives. And we just come in asking you to anoint this time this morning. May we become hearers and doers of the word that will bring glory and honor praise to you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yeah. country, wherever you are this morning, whether it be in your house, in your car, wherever it may be, to just worship Him this morning. You know, He's still on the throne. He is still God. He's God above every circumstance and every trial. He's God above this virus. He's God above every circumstance in our lives. We just challenge you this morning to continue to worship. Let's just pray together. Father, we just pray now for your people as they're listening. God, we pray for our church, for the people that that don't attend our church that may be listening this morning. God, we just pray for them. God, that you would just comfort their hearts, comfort their lives, God. God, that you would meet their needs. God, that you would take away fear, that you would take away worry. And Lord, that you would just bring faith into their lives and faith into their family and faith into their homes this morning. God, we love you, we thank you, we praise you for all you're doing. God, we just know that you are still on the throne. You are God over the circumstance. And we will worship you every moment of every day. We love you and praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yeah.
Praise God, church. You know, this might seem a little awkward to you right now, but I just want everybody where you're at with your family or the room you're in. Might seem awkward. I want you to just begin to praise God for who He is. Praise God for what He's doing in your life. Praise God that He's going to get you through everything and every battle that you're going through. And just begin to praise Him for who He is. The King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. He's the lifter of our head. He is our bread of life. He's our salvation. He's our everything. And we just need to give God praise for all that He's doing. Give God praise for everything. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the word today, Father God, that's going to come forth. Thank you for this time of praise and worship that we can enter into your presence, Father God. Enter into the holy place, Father God, face to face with you, Father. And just say, Lord, here we are. We want to worship you. We want to praise you. We want to all that you have for us because we want to go out and make a difference in this world. And we just give you the praise for it right now, Father. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Praise God. Church, we're going to win the battles. And we're going to be looking at two scriptures this morning. We're going to be looking at Isaiah 54 and Ephesians chapter 6. But I want you to turn with me this morning to Isaiah chapter 54 and verse 17. Now, what we see in this verse is that the battle that we're in is fixed. God's already got it set up. And in 54, verse 17, it says, no weapon forged against you will prevail, and you will refute every tongue that accuses you. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and this is their vindication from me, declares the Lord. No matter how hard the devil, no matter how hard this world tried, listen, God has destined His children to win the battles. Our part is basically just holding on to Jesus and being there with Him. Remember what I said last week in John chapter 4. He said, peace I live with you. Peace I give you. He's given us His peace that passes all understanding. And what I love is this peace overrides fear. This peace overrides anxiety. This peace overrides worry. No weapon of fear, no weapon of worry, no weapon of anxiety will forge against you and will prosper. They can be formed against you. As we see in a minute, we can see where it can be formed against us. But it says that it cannot prosper unless we allow that weapon to come in and prosper inside of us. How many times has another country bragged about taking America down? But how many have accomplished that task? How many remember in 1988 a historic event took place? The Berlin Wall came down. The symbol of communist domineering fell. The wall coming down stood for the fall of communism. Church, one day, Satan's empire is going to come crashing down. And we are going to get to see that happen. We're in a battle where we're going to see spiritual Berlin walls coming down, church. Many people right now are going through some tough times. Knowing that God is with you and cares about you, that's what's going to get you through these rough times. See, God turns things around for His children. In verses 15 to 16, if anyone does attack you, it will not be by my doing. God has not caused this coronavirus. Whoever attacks you will surrender to you. We're going to make this coronavirus surrender to us. See, it is I who created the blacksmith, who fans the coals in the flame and forges a weapon fit for his work. And it's I who have created the destroyer to work havoc. A blacksmith. See, the blacksmith is the one who makes the weapon. Destroyer is the one who uses the weapons to fight with. God created the blacksmith. God created the destroyer. But this means if God created these men, God knows everything about them, and He knows everything about the weapons and how they will be used against us. The blacksmith, no weapon that he forges can come against me. The destroyer, he comes to kill, steal, destroy, but it ain't gonna happen. Because I trust God with all my heart. Listen, we have to understand that God has determined for us to defeat the devil. Amen. The devil is determined to beat you, but we have been predetermined to destroy the devil's works. And by faith, I'm here to tell you, the devil is going down, church. And every Christian needs to know this, that the devil is out to destroy every Christian on this earth. The Bible tells us that he's like a roaring lion seeking to whom he can devour. That he comes to kill, steal, and destroy. But there's no word in the Word saying that he can do it unless we allow him to come into our life. And by allowing him, we begin to walk in that fear, that anxiety, that worry. We begin to doubt God, quit trusting God, quit walking in obedience to God. And when that happens, the devil is going to lunge on top of you. And church, we can never get comfortable in our walk, because when we become comfortable, that is when the enemy is going to come in and defeat us. It's kind of like, if you just think about this for a moment, a soldier that's in a battle. And there's a war raging around them. This battle is just taking place around them. And they decide, well, I think I'm just going to get comfortable in this thing. I'm going to sit down, relax, prop my feet up. And the battle is raging. Do you not think that's when the enemy is going to come and attack and take you down? It's when you become comfortable in where you're at. Listen, when I get comfortable, that's when the attacks come. Because the devil's waiting for us to get comfortable instead of walking in what God has us to do. You have got to determine who your enemy is. It isn't your neighbor. It isn't your co-worker. It isn't none of your family members. We have to realize it's the devil. He doesn't like us. And he is forging weapons to go up against us. And we have to know that he has studied our weaknesses. He knows the people that we hang around. And he knows that some of these that are not Christians can actually pull us down. And what situations that come against you that can shake your faith? See, the devil's studying you. He's looking at all these things. He's looking to see what kind of situation he can get you in that will bring you down. He's looking at these friends that you're hanging out with that's drinking and partying and seeing what they can do to bring you down, to turn you away from God. He has studied you. He designs different weapons that he knows that is best fit to bring you down. He has studied and knows what those weapons are. These weapons bring spiritual confusion in our lives. People are confused right now with this coronavirus. Well, am I to do this? Or am I to do that? Or am I supposed to go and do this thing or that? And we read so much confusion, and I'm like, what am I supposed to do? I don't know. I'm hearing all these different things on the news. I'm supposed to do this. This is going to happen. This one. Not this. And we're just getting confused. And that's what the devil's trying to bring that confusion in. He knows your defense and what's best and effective to go against that defense. These weapons are ones that you would not even expect to come against you. Things that would throw you off track. You're headed this way. And he knows that. Now, if he can just get you to turn around, because, again, he has studied you, and he knows what gets you to turn and begin to go away from God, and he has studied trying to get you to do that. And he knows if you've been with God. He knows if you're praying. He knows if you're seeking God's face. He knows, are you still living like you did when you first got saved? He knows all these things. You know, when Peter and John went and they healed this lame man, and they were brought before the Sanhedrin, and this is what I love. They said, hey, there's something about these guys. They're untrained, they're uneducated, but there's something about them. And that something is, we can tell that they've been with Jesus. It's time for Christians to get with Jesus. Begin to pray and seek his face. Listen, the devil knows your past. He knows your past hurts. He knows your rejections, your depressions, your addictions. And see, if he can just stop us from trusting God, then he has made us ineffective for the kingdom of God. Listen, church, no weapon forged against you can prosper. That one little word is so important. Can. See, the enemy can't stop you from winning the battle, unless you just, okay, I'm going to get comfortable. And he comes in, and he begins to take you down. That one little word is so important. See, the root word prosper in Hebrew means to push forward. See, I think we kind of like need to be like an elephant. How many know, can you move an elephant if you push against him? No. So we need to be like that elephant. Be that elephant that when the enemy comes and he tries to push you, and he tries to bring that fear, that anxiety, that worry inside of you, that they can't push you. They can't push you. That you're standing still and standing firm for God. Be like that elephant. You guys got to say, devil, listen, you can't push me around. You can't take me the place you went. I am standing firm in my belief in God, and I'm going to do what God has called me to do. In the battle of David and Goliath, whose sword did David pick up and cut the head of the giant off? It was Goliath's own sword. That is called a victory. And this kind of victory, God wants to give us. God has given every child of his this unique armor in Ephesians chapter 6. And I want you to turn over that. In verses 10, in Ephesians chapter 6, God wants to give us a victory. And we know that the enemy forges these weapons up against us. And so God has given us this spiritual armor of God to go against any weapon that the devil has to throw against us. And in Ephesians 5, 2 through 8, James says, finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's sin. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the power of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything to stand, stand firm. Then with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace, in addition to all this, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions, with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the saints. Listen, as we look into this word, we've seen, you can see so many ways that God has given us to defend ourselves against the enemy. And right now, every person in this country, every person in our counties, in our cities, are going through some rough times. Listen, I believe the church needs to be the church today, offering God's love and hope to this world. And God has given every child this armor for protection. But it's also, I believe, used for the advancing forward the kingdom. And I believe it's every pastor's responsibility to equip their people with the information that protects them from these spiritual attacks in your everyday battles. For we're in a war right now called the coronavirus war. And these battles, they come from this war, which is fear battle, the fear battle, the anxiety battle, the worry battle. And in verses 10 through 13, what's taking place? Paul is preparing us for battle. As children of God, we're told to put on the armor of God. Now, how much of the armor are we to put on? Do we just put on the helmet of salvation? Well, like I say, I can go out and conquer the world now. No, you can't. The world is going to conquer you. But when you take on the whole armor of God that protects your whole body, then you can go out and begin to move forward to what God has. And we're not just called to put on the hammer of salvation one day, breastplate of righteousness another day, belt of truth the next day, shod the feet of the preparation of the gospel. No, we are to put on the whole armor of God every day. What Paul is saying is, listen, It's time for Christians to suit up for the battle that are here and the battles that are coming. Listen, after the coronavirus goes away, another battle is going to come into our lives. And the war we're fighting right now, this bacterial war. And in a war, how many know you have battles that break off from these wars? And these battles are the fear, the anxiety, the worry. And there's more that goes with that. And understand that these are all spiritual battles. Our battle's not against flesh and blood. So these battles are manifesting from this coronavirus war. David cut off the head of Goliath, as I said earlier. And what was he doing? He was showing the Israelite army that, listen, the fear that we had from this giant is now gone. The giant has been taken down. Church, if we cut off the head of fear, if we cut off the head of worry, if we cut off the head of anxiety, the manifestation of fear is going to die. But we've got to take up the sword of the Spirit. We've got to take up the Word of God. Goliath was not dead until the head was cut off. And the fear in the soldiers did not leave until they saw that head unattached from the body. When we take off the head of fear, the body dies. And we've got to begin to do that. We've got to begin, how do you do that? You take the sword of spirit, you take this armor that God has given us, and we begin to cut off the enemy's head. We begin to cut off these things that are coming against us. Because we are more than overcomers by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of our testimony. So it's time to suit up for this battle. When we fight these spiritual battles and win, see, it causes us to do what the word says, to take up and stand against the devil's schemes. Stand your ground. And when you've done everything, to continue to stand. Listen, we're called to move forward, to advance forward. And there's going to be times when I come against my fear, when I come against my anxiety, when I come against worry, doubt, unforgiveness, all these things. I come up against them. I just got to look at them and say, pal, I'm getting ready to take your head off. Because I am more than overcome by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of my testimony. You cannot defeat me. For God has given me the power. God has given me the anointing. God has given me everything I need to take you down. So fear, you're going down. Anxiety, you're going down. Worry, you're going down. Unforgiveness, you're going down. Doubt, you're going down. All these things, addictions, you're going down because the power is inside of me. God has given me the victory. The victory is mine, not yours. And I want to advance forward because God has told me not to run, but to advance forward. And if there's time I have to stand and come against you, I will do that, but I'm taking you down. Then I'm moving forward to what God has. Because my destiny is ahead of me. It's not behind me. It's ahead of me. And I'm going to fulfill my destiny that God has for me. And so nothing can stand in my way. We got to quit backing down. And don't remove any part of your armor. God says to put on the whole armor of God. Don't take it off when you go to bed. Don't take it off when you feel comfortable. You got to keep that armor off 24/7. Three days, a week. And continue to keep it on. I've been a Christian for 30-something years now. I have not taken off the armor of God. Because I know when I do, the devil is going to come against me because he knows my weaknesses. And that's what we got to do. We got to get to that place where we're going to make the devil tremble. Listen, we got to understand who and whose we are. You are a spirit-filled child of God who is fully prepared to take on the devil. Let hell know who and whose you are. Make those demons in here in hell fearful of you because you know who you are and you know who you belong to. And if you know who you are, who you belong to, no demon in hell can take you down. We got to begin to put everything we have into God. Paul tells us in verse 14, 17, to stand firm and to place that armor on you. What armor? The belt of truth. Who is the truth? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can go to the Father except through me. Muhammad can't get you there. Buddha can't get you there. All these other gods cannot get you there. The only person that can get you there is Jesus Christ. There's no this way or that way. There's only one way to the kingdom of God. One way into the arms of Jesus, and that's through Jesus.
Yes.
And we got to quit looking for all these other things. There's only one way. Jesus Christ. Church, the truth is that God is in complete control. Truth sets us free from worry, anxiety, and fear. Then we have the breastplate of righteousness. Righteousness covers our hearts. Church, we have got to begin to guard our hearts. We got to begin to keep our hearts pure before God. You know, if you want to win your battles, then keep yourself pure, because it produces power, which means you need the strength of God's righteousness to have these victories. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. What do we fill our hearts with? We fill our hearts with faith from the Word of God. And that faith produces that power that makes us more than overcomers. Number three, we shut our feet in the preparation of the gospel. What this is telling us, we have always got to be prepared. We got to be prepared to carry this word in us so that our mouth can speak it. If we don't have the word in us, then how can our mouth speak it? And let me tell you, I've said it to you before, and if you're not, if it's your first time hearing, is that it's my responsibility to feed you the Word of God, but it's not my responsibility for you to read the Word of God to you. You've got to begin to read it. How do you know whether I'm telling you the truth or not if you haven't read it?
Amen.
You've got to begin to read the Word. And I suggest when you get offline here and the preaching's done, to go back and study. And if I've messed up in the Word, let me know. But I know the Word is truth. And don't just take somebody's word for it. I used to do that. I used to say, well, if I'm listening, someone might ask me, what went on in the church that day? I might say, well, the preacher said. Well, it was good what the preacher said, but is God saying it too? Sometimes man can say something and ain't God saying it. So I want to encourage you to read it. Take it for yourself. Study the Word. Know that that man in that pulpit, that woman in that pulpit is telling you what the Word of God is saying. And you've got to prepare yourself for the Word. This means to always be prepared to carry this Word inside you. Luke 4 says, the Spirit of the Lord is on me. He has appointed me. He has anointed me. He has prepared me to go out and preach the good news. He has sent me to proclaim freedom to those who are prisoners. Prisoners of what? Prisoners of fear, worry, anxiety, unforgiveness, hatred, bitterness, depression, oppression. And we can go on down the list. He has sent me, he has sent you to lay hands on the sick, to proclaim the year of the Lord. So one day Jesus Christ is coming back. And the question is, are we going to be ready? Listen, I don't care how many books out there are telling you when Jesus is coming back. I can't give you 88 reasons why Jesus is coming back. Because no one knows when he's coming. And this point gets, I've said before, is that if God hasn't told Jesus, why is he going to tell somebody else? When he's ready, he's going to say, son, go get him. And when that way God says, and when God says, son, go get him, Jesus is coming and taking his children back. And we're going to go into the kingdom of God. We're going to go into the heavens. We're going to live an eternal life with him. But until that day comes, go out, lay hands on the sick, proclaim the freedom to the prisoners, declare the day of the Lord, anoint and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. There's people out there suffering, people having problems and going through things, and they need people as Christians to go out and say, listen, Jesus loves you. Begin to pray hands, lay hands on him, pray for him. And I know we have this 6-foot distance. Let me tell you, God can work through that 6-foot distance too, okay? progression is done through discipleship. And discipleship is done through mentoring in the spiritual realm. When you go out, do you care about people? Do you share the love of Jesus? Do you pray for the sick? So we have to understand we are his feet, we are his hands, his eyes, his ears, his mouth to this world. That we need to go out into every day. And the shield of faith. With faith, we quench the darts of hell. See, Satan tries to puncture you with these darts of doubt, fear, worry, anxiety, unforgiveness, depression, etc. See, if he can puncture you a hole in your faith, then he can start bringing you down. Because when my faith is punctured, then I begin to lose trust in God. I begin to walk away from God. I begin to worry. I begin to have this fear and anxiety. I begin to have doubt. And I begin, and next thing I know, I'm not walking with Jesus anymore. I'm giving over to the things of this world. And our faith, the devil knows if he can get a hold of your faith, he can start bringing you down. You got to keep that faith up and protect your body. The helmet of salvation. How many have some stinking thinking problems in your mind? You know, when I gave my life to Jesus on that day, my mind was renewed. And every day it is continuing to be renewed. As long as I keep the helmet of salvation on. Listen, church. We have been redeemed from the curse of the law. Cleansed by the blood of Jesus. Washed and made clean. Don't let the enemy come in and try to put you back in your past. Because all things have passed away. And all things have become new. We've got to begin to believe this. In Ephesians 4, 22 through 24. It says, you were taught with regard to your former way of life. To put off your old self, which is being corrupted by his deceitful desires, to be made new and active in your minds, and to put on the new self created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. The word says the former ways of life. Thank you, Jesus, that I don't have to live the way I used to. The thing is that, see, I chose to live that way. Turning my life over to Jesus in high school, then after high school, getting away from God and walking away from Him and just spending 8 years of hell in my life with alcohol, drugs, having a full scholarship, playing football at Wofford and giving it up to go work in a bar and to begin to take that step backwards. And all of a sudden the devil tries to bring that past up. And it brings those hurts. You know, and I look back and I see all those people that I've hurt. People that tried to help me during that time that I wouldn't listen to. Because I had this mindset that I could do it myself. And I hurt a lot of people during that time. And I don't want to go back to that. But the devil would do everything he can to get us in our past hurts. To take us back to where those things were crippling us and keeping us from living what God wants to live. But see, it wasn't until I got tired of running away from God and I decided to turn and to run to God. See, that's the difference. Is are you running away from God or are you turning to God? And I want you to know that God said, I will never leave you, I'll never forsake you, I'll always be with you. Jesus never left me during those times. I left him. But Jesus was up there. And he came in and changed my life. We need to begin to run towards God again, church. The sword of the Spirit, our offensive weapon, church. All the others, defensive weapons. God has called us to advance forward. There's no protection for the back. And the word here is a weapon to defeat my enemy. Without it, I am defeated. Without this right here, I cannot defeat the enemy. I cannot go up against the enemy if I don't have this inside of me, if I'm not living by this word of God, the enemy is going to take me down every day. Every battle that comes up against me because I'm not trusting in God, because I'm not reading this word, what happens is the devil knows that he comes and begins to take us down. There is no weapon that can defeat me unless I turn away from God. And I've heard it said before, the word will work if you work the word. And I love that. I stand upon this word that teaches me righteousness, this word that teaches me truth, this word that teaches me about my salvation, this word that teaches me about my faith, this word that teaches me about the peace that passes all understanding. Get into the word and read it, church, and prayer. He says we are to take all these weapons and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayer requests and keep praying for the saints. We've got to begin to pray for each other. It's time for the church to pray. It's past time for the church to pray. 2 Chronicles 7:14, I've heard over and over again through this coronavirus. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and seek my face and turn from the wicked ways, I will hear from heaven and I will heal their land. Church, again, turn from your wicked ways. Turn from your past and begin to turn towards God. Begin to seek God's face. Thank God that on that day that Jesus died on the cross, that the veil was torn in two, which says, I can go into the Holy of Holies. I can go in face to face with God. I don't have to rely on a priest. I don't have to rely on somebody else going to God for it. I can go before God, and I can kneel before Him and say, God, thank you for who you are. God, thank you that you saved my life. God, I need you. I need your anointing. I need your power. And Jesus said, you got it, bro. You've got that power. You've got that anointing. I've sent the Holy Spirit to give you power to be a testimony for me. Church, if my people do we need healing, then we got to begin to humble ourselves and pray, seek God's face like we never have done before. Guess what? I don't know how many people agree with this, but I do not believe it is the unbeliever's responsibility to pray. God said, if my people who humble, who are called by my name. Now, if we're expecting the unbelievers to pray for us, we're going to be in a mess. Because we don't know who they're praying to. To me, they're just praying to an empty wall if you're praying to Buddha, if you're praying to all these other gods. But to me, I'm praying to God. And he says to seek his faith, not some fortune teller, not some other book, but to seek the face of God. And if it says to seek the face of God, God will heal us and heal our land. He's waiting for us to speak to him. Are you a child of God in that church? It's time to pray. How do we pray? We pray in the Spirit. See, I have tried just to pray myself, and I have not been effective. But I realized that my prayers become more effective when I partner with the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit begins to allow my prayers, my requests, to be made known to the Father. Church, right now, this day that we're living in, we're having some rough times, making decisions that we thought we would never make before. Someone watching their loved ones go through sickness, money evaporating before them. And all this is doing is bringing the battles in our lives. It's bringing the battle of fear, anxiety of where am I going to get the money for this? They're sick. Do they have the coronavirus? I don't know. And we're walking around in fear. We're walking all these things. And I believe the world needs to see Christians that are fighting the battle. I know Pastor Jason Wednesday night in his teaching was talking about Jesus walking on water and the disciples in the boat with the storm. And as I heard that, God began to show me something. That all the people, all the those that were on the boat, all the disciples, were in the same position. Listen, Christians and unbelievers, right now we're all in the same position. We're all fighting against this coronavirus. And when Peter got out of the boat, see, when at that point, everybody's eyes were on Jesus. But when Peter got out of the boat, I believe their eyes went to Peter to see what he was going to do. To see, is he going to sink? Is he going to drown? What's he going to do? And what they were doing is they were looking at, see what kind of faith that Peter had. So they didn't have that faith to get out of that boat. But they were the onlookers. And see, when Peter began to take his eyes off of Jesus and began to look at the storm of the wave, he began to sink. But Jesus came. And then I think their eyes went from Peter to Jesus to see what Jesus was going to do. And they saw that Jesus came, and he grabbed Peter, and he took him back to the boat. See, they were all in the same position. Right now, we're all in the same position. But many eyes are on Christians to see what they are going to do. Are they going to continue to walk in their faith? Are they willing to get out of the water with their faith? And to not walk in fear. Not to see, for Peter to get out of that boat, he couldn't have fear. He couldn't have anxiety. He couldn't worry. All he had was his eyes on Jesus. We got to keep our eyes on Jesus. And Jesus is going to get us through this, church. We're living in those rough times. And my words of encouragement to you today is, God is in control. This coronavirus did not come as a shock to God. He wasn't surprised. He said, what? There's a coronavirus episode going on in the world? I didn't know that. Why didn't somebody tell me? Don't anybody tell me anything? No, God already knew. God wasn't shocked. Like, oh, you gotta be joking. No. God knew. God knows everything that goes on. What helps me to know is that I have a friend that sticks closer than a brother. And his name is Jesus, who said that he would never leave me, he would never forsake me, for he would always be with me. I have that assurance that Jesus is with me through all this stuff, through the fear, through the anxiety, through the work, through the all that. Jesus is with me to get me through it. And if I fall, Jesus picks me up because he loves me. And yes, we all want to fall. I wish I could sit up here and say, hey, I don't have problems. I don't have fear. I don't have it. But I'm saying this. We all have it. But do we have that friend that's closer than a brother? Do we have Jesus that's there to help pick us up and to get us back to the boat, to get us back to safety? Jesus is there always with us. And I close with these words. No weapon formed against you can prosper because you have the armor of God. Listen, it says on and not on and off. Keep your armor on because it never says to take it off. Jesus has already given it to us. And if you're listening to this message and you have never given your heart over to Jesus, maybe you're walking in some fear, some worry, anxiety, then I'm here to tell you that this day is for you. This is the day of salvation for you. And all you have to do is right where you're at right now, ask Jesus to come into your heart and say, Jesus, forgive me. Forgive me for the wrong thinking, for stinking thinking. And Lord, I thank you right now. I know who you are. And I confess with my mouth and I believe in my heart that Jesus Christ is who he is. And he's no longer in that grave, but he's with the Father. And one day he's coming back for me. And I just ask right now that you ask Jesus into your heart. Just where you're at, just say, Jesus, come into my heart. And I'm going to pray for you. He gave his life on the cross so that you could live for him with all eternity. So just right now, ask him into your heart. And ask him to become your Lord and Savior. So let's pray right now. As I pray, I want to come against fear, worry, and anxiety. I'm going to pray peace upon everyone listening to this live streaming today. I want to pray over those families that are hurting. I want to release an anointing of God and safety upon those who are on the front line fighting this war against the coronavirus. So, Father, right now in Jesus' name, Lord, we know the enemy comes to kill, steal, and destroy. We know that the enemy comes with these weapons against us. But we're here to declare that no weapon of fear, no weapon of anxiety, no weapon of worry can come in and overcome us, because we're under the blood of Jesus Christ. We have His anointing in our life. And I cast out all fear right now in Jesus' name. And Lord, that people will walk in victory today. They'll quit walking in defeat, and they'll walk in victory, because You've already given us the victory. You've given us the battle. All we have to do is show up, stand, move forward, and win the battle that You've given us. We're going to have battles every day. But through Jesus Christ, we have victory every day. Hallelujah. And I pray for that peace that passes all understanding. Father, that peace that Jesus said, I leave with You, that peace I give to You now. Walk in that peace. Walk in that trust. Walk in that faith. Walk in that truth. Walk in Your salvation. Walk in the sword of the Spirit. Walk with the sword of the Spirit. And then cut off the head of the enemy. And have the victory that I have already given You. Glory to God. And so, Father, right now, I release an anointing in these homes, in these cars, wherever they're listening. I release this anointing upon their life right now, Father God. May they begin to know who and whose they are. May they begin to walk in the things of victory. Walk in the things of You, Father God. Oh Lord, You've given us all these victories. You've given us all the things we need to have, Father God. We are equipped with all the provisions that we need, Father God. May we walk in trust with You, Father. Lord, I know there's people that are hurting. I just pray right now, Lord, that we be there for one another. That we lift one another up so that each one of us can walk in that victory that we already have. And be an encouragement to different ones. To give them a phone call and say, how you doing? To give them a text and say, how you doing through this? I'm praying for you. I love you. People need to hear these words of encouragement. And I pray that they'll have the anointing to keep going forward, Father God. Lord, that we don't allow the enemy to move us backwards, to go to the past, but to keep advancing forward to what You have for us. That You've given us the whole armor. You've given us the hammer of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the belt of truth. We have the peace. We have the shield of faith. We have the sword of the Spirit. The sword of the Spirit that cuts off the heads of the enemy. And so, Father, I thank You that today people begin to walk in victory, walk in love, Lord God. There's so many hurting. But Lord, I thank You that You're such an amazing God that loves us and cares about us. That You've never left us, You've never forsaken us. Your word says You'll always be with us. And we cling to You, Father God, to walk in faith. Walk in hope, to walk in Your glory, Father God. We love You, Jesus. And I just pray for any that are sitting among us today, Father God. I come against that sickness today in Jesus' name. And I pray an anointing of healing to be in and through them right now, Father. In the glorious name of Jesus. We love You so much, Father. In Jesus' name. Amen. I just want to encourage you. We had a lot of people ask about how can they give. And if you want to do it three ways, if you want to just hang on to your tithe and pay up whenever everything comes back to normal, you can do that. Or if you want to write a check, just send it into the church. Or you can go online and www.lifechurchmonroe. And there's a place on there that you can pay by credit card or debit card. But I want to encourage you to keep walking in the faith and be an example to those around you and love on them. And I just pray God's blessing. Don't forget Wednesday night, Pastor Jason. You'll be teaching on Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. Go to the Facebook page and listen in. Does a tremendous job. And know that we love you so much. God bless you. May God be with you continually. Good night.